Soil is life. There are more living organisms in a teaspoon of fertile soil than there are humans on Earth, and life depends on it. More specifically, we rely on only 6 inches of its top layer, the topsoil, where microorganisms support plants and growing nutritious food. Unfortunately, how we have come to grow our food is harming our soil and the many life forms that depend on it. But this can change. Depending on what we do, we can actually regenerate the soil.
The great thing about regenerative farming is that you can absorb a lot of CO2 from the atmosphere. All the CO2 kind of gets absorbed by the plants, they do photosynthesis and basically store it in the soil, the roots give it to all the little bacteria and microorganisms, they then turn it into healthy soil, and that means they help us solve climate change.
People always wonder about, can regenerative agriculture be scaled? Yes, of course it can be scaled. It's already been shown in multiple peer-reviewed papers that this type of farming produces a whole rounded human diet, and B, a much more higher level of nutrient per given area than modern industrial ag does.
So what is regeneration? It is social, economic and ecological win-win-win. Why? Because if one of these is not a win, you're still exploiting something, whether it's the soil or the farmer or the life at your farm.
Half of the world's habitable land today is used for agriculture. How we treat our soil can play a big role in combating climate change, but hardly anyone is talking about it. Why is that, and how can small-scale regenerative agriculture change it? Regenerative agriculture is a set of farming practices that constantly restores biodiversity on farmland, starting with life in the soil.
With regenerative farming, you're basically always kind of improving the system. You're not only increasing the biodiversity, but you're also increasing the fertility of the soil. That's exactly the opposite of what has happened in the last 50 years. And because of that, we had to throw more and more fertilizers on the fields, which, yeah, made the food less healthy, less tasty, but also just caused a lot of environmental problems and a lot of greenhouse gas emissions and so on.
Wenn du eine gesunde Pflanze hast, die mit allem versorgt wird über die Bodenorganismen, was die Pflanze braucht, dann kann sie eben auch viel, viel nährstoffhaltigere Nahrung produzieren. Ein ganz anderes Nahrungsmittel. Es ist ein Nahrungsmittel, anders vielleicht als so eine Junkie-Pflanze, die mit Mühe und Not am Leben erhalten wird, indem sie künstlich gefüttert wird. Die hat natürlich bei Weitem nicht diese Bandbreite an Nährstoffe vielleicht zur Verfügung und kann sie dementsprechend auch nirgendwo einlagern und ist ein ganz anderes Produkt am Ende. Und das wäre eben schön, wenn man sowas auch mal vergleichbar machen würde. Das ist was, was man leider nicht sehen kann. Eine Tomate aus dem Supermarkt sieht ja genauso aus wie unsere Tomate.
One of the main principles that sort of runs this farm is that I recognize that soil life is a much better farmer than I could ever be as a human being. And that's where it all starts. And by recognizing that, you don't want to make a top-down garden in which you control everything as a human being.
J'ai eu l'impression, quand on a commencé à parler d'agriculture de régénération, de découvrir une vie souterraine incroyable. Me dire, mais en fait, on sous-estime complètement, quand on regarde ces champs, ce qui se passe en dessous. J'ai eu l'impression que tout à coup, il y avait un univers, tout un univers qui s'ouvrait à moi. Et je sais pas, peut-être que quand on n'en a pas conscience, c'est plus difficile d'envisager que le sol puisse lui-même se régénérer quelque part, enfin de manière naturelle en tout cas.
So regenerative agriculture, in a way, is first and foremost a change of mindset. But what does it actually look like? That depends, because every soil landscape is different. As a general rule, regenerative agriculture is about growing soil. And the best way to do that is by not disturbing it and letting it do its magic. Don't tilt or overplow the soil. Grow a whole bunch of plants on your farm, not just one or two, and keep your soil covered with crops and trees that protect it from the sun, wind or frost. All of this helps protect the soil, which is full of living organisms that are helpful for plants. For example, some tiny organisms help plants absorb nitrogen, which they need to kick off the photosynthesis process in order to grow. In exchange, plants will feed those microorganisms carbon from the air. Some bacteria then use that carbon to build the very soil in which new plants can grow.
Since our current problem of climate crisis has been caused by a large extent to burning fossil fuels, and setting free carbon dioxide, We need to capture the carbon and bring it back into the soil, like where the oil and the gas came from. And that is done through plants growing and working them into the soil.
We release far more carbon into the atmosphere every year through bad soil management than we do from all industry and transportation combined. Most people don't know that.
We've grown accustomed to seeing farmland as spaces cleared of any cover and just full of monocultures. But ecologically speaking, that's nonsense. By adding other plants like trees, you're not only protecting the soil, you'll also end up growing better, stronger crops.
What you need to do to basically have productive agricultural systems again is to bring complexity back. So that means that you're not only growing one crop, but you're actually ideally growing various crops at the same time that actually work together and make the system more productive.
Trees have a huge role. Of course, they provide fodder and food and fuel, but additionally, no one's better, maybe algae is a bit better, but than trees at sequestering carbon. So by establishing this perennial agriculture, we're doing our part to put carbon back in the soil, you know, take it down out of the atmosphere and put it into the ground where it belongs. We humans have a lot to learn from plants. They're much better at collaborating than we are, I think.
And so while industrial agriculture seeks to produce as much of any one crop as possible by using chemical fertilizers and pesticides, in regenerative agriculture, the goal is to create as many relationships between living things as possible. And you are one of those things.
So it's all about collaborating with other species in a way that's beneficial to all and trying to create abundance in the process. So I try to farm soil life. Like, what we try to do is not a reductionist thinking, okay, I have a problem, I need to fix it, so I need to shoot or kill something. What we try to do here is wonder, okay, if I have an issue, what am I actually missing? What can I add? And that's how you build up diversity and complexity.
Today, our agricultural industry uses more energy than it produces. It emits more greenhouse gas emissions than old planes, cars, and ships combined. And most of the crops it produces are not even grown for humans to eat, but to feed cattle. This brings us to one of the biggest discussions in agriculture, animals. Specifically, how much of farming and resources revolves around them and their role in the creation or destruction of topsoil. Leaving aside the ethics of an industry that tends to mistreat animals, another technique to build up topsoil, which has gained traction in regenerative circles, is rotation animal grazing. The theory goes like this. Instead of holding cattle in feedlots, which exhaust the soil, they are moved from one plot to the next. Grazing can shock plants into growing and expanding their roots, hence kicking off the photosynthesis cycle that captures carbon.
As stewards of the land, it's very easy to destroy soil by fire, by overgrazing animals. That means having animals in one place for too long a time. But we also know how to build soil through grazing animals. I've documented a 25 centimeter increase in our active topsoil in the first 4 years of our farm through healthy management of grazing animals, essentially.
And I see that also in our field. There's a clear difference, for example, in the grass growth and the root depth of the plants in the places where the animals have been and where the animals have not been.
There have been studies that support these claims, while others question them. One study from the University of Oxford estimates that holistic management can only offset 20 to 60% of the CO2 produced by one's grazing animals. And that's under perfect conditions. These questions, as well as ethical issues surrounding farm animals, have led some people to look for other ways to build topsoil while protecting biodiversity, completely without farm animals.
Die Mist ist ja extrem divers in der Biologie, besiedelt mit Bakterien und allen möglichen Kulturen. Und darüber kann man natürlich auch Diversität in den Boden bringen. Man kann das auch kompostieren und die Bakterien sich da vermehren lassen und das auf den Boden bringen. Das ist ja nicht grundsätzlich falsch, nur ist es nicht essentiell.
In reality, having animals on a farm, it's just that we have a loop more in the circle. Nature has given us a great opportunity to improve soil fertility just by plants. This is the big family of plants which is called leguminous. These are nitrogen collecting plants. They have a symbiosis with bacteria in the root system, which are able to collect the nitrogen of the air. So these plants do not do not need any other fertilizer. They grow by themselves, literally, using the nitrogen of the air. When we incorporate these plants into the soil, we add a huge amount of nitrogen into the soil. You can imagine that we steadily we can upgrade the fertility of the soil. And of course, this does not go from one day to another. It's a process.
Globally, livestock grazing uses up to 26% of habitable land, making it a comparably inefficient way of producing protein. If we want to avoid using up even more land, if we want to preserve our ecosystems and dramatically reduce emissions, we need to not only move away from industrial agriculture, it would also be difficult to get around reducing our demand for meat, which only an industrial system can satisfy. In order to do this, though, farmers whose livelihoods depend on cattle holding today will need ample support to transition. Which brings us to another contentious issue. Can regenerative agriculture be scaled? And can small-scale agriculture actually feed the world?
Faire des choses plus. Après, il y a plein de gens qui pensent que c'est pas possible de nourrir l'humanité avec ce type de ferme. Finalement, quand on voit que la plupart des aliments sont produits pour nourrir le bétail ou faire des carburants, des agrocarburants, on se dit que si, en fait, il y a beaucoup de gâchis et une mauvaise distribution, mais on pourrait totalement nourrir le pays avec des exploitations diversifiées comme ça. Je pense, moi, j'ai aucun doute là-dessus.
Today, large-scale agriculture only accounts for 50% of food production, while the rest comes from small-scale farmers, and we need more of that. The main obstacle to scaling regenerative agriculture is that industrial agriculture is currently more heavily subsidized than regenerative approaches. That's why Ecosia has launched a regenerative agroforestry fund to help people launch or switch to a regenerative farming project.
We at Ecosia thought, can we play a role in speeding that up? Can we support especially farms that then become examples for other farmers so that basically they can copy what has been done successfully at other farms? Many of those farms are also just really great places for social interaction. So a lot of people coming together, actually producing food together, I think that is a great piece of what humanity should be about.
But changing our agricultural system will need more than just the funds from a social search engine. It needs a structural change driven not only by governmental funding, but also by redefining the role of farmers in our society.
So that's the sad position of nearly all modern farmers, is that they are working on a credit card. They're using their soil resources. And then most of them who are locked down by debt that the young generation can't afford to buy them out. So they're left working physically very demanding jobs way beyond when any human should be doing that. And they can't get out the game and new people can't get in the game.
Mais ça prend du temps. Donc je pense qu'en étant nous-mêmes confrontés aux réalités de l'agriculture et en côtoyant des agriculteurs, on se dit voilà, c'est pas que des méchantes personnes qui veulent détruire la terre, ils font aussi face à beaucoup de problèmes quoi.
So this approach to modern farming where we're living on debasing our very soil resources leads to most of those farmers telling their sons and daughters, farming doesn't pay, go to the city, get a real job. And that scares the life out of me, because in one or two generations we can lose a massive rural knowledge base. Scaling up regenerative agriculture is pretty simple. Scaling up the amount of farmers is the challenge.
The political will to support the transition towards regenerative farming also depends on us. By changing how we eat, we also demand a change in how we treat our farmers and our planet, two things we depend on.